Hello, good people. It has been such a long time since we've had a video with anything about flight attendant in the title, honey. And I know what y'all are gonna ask, and I'm not even gonna hold y'all. Nope, I am not. But watch this last vlog. Watch this last vlog first, and at the end, I will give you the whole rundown, okay? Hello, lovely people. Welcome back to the channel. I'm Alexia Nicole, and I'm living my life by design. Back in Dallas, just landed after a crazy week in Houston, Texas. I've come back to Dallas to start a 4-day trip. And I miss my car. My car has been here more than a week. It's been about 10 days or so. So I hope my car is still out there. No damage from all the crazy winter storm. Not even like prepared as far as like food and stuff. I really don't want to eat out every day, but I was busy. So maybe I'll run to the grocery store before I go to the crash pad and see if I can pick up some stuff. The trip doesn't, I think my report time tomorrow is like at 11 a.m. ish, something like that. So we'll see what we can get there. Whew. But yes, back to work. Let's go. Mahogany is still there. By the grace of God, I remember where I parked. Oh, okay. Before I left, her tire pressure was low. That cold weather don't really help with that. Okay. Boo looks good. She's filthy, but she looked good. She here, dusty, but we're here. Hallelujah. Okay, I'm craving some spaghetti, y'all. I think I'm about to go to the grocery store and go get some stuff to make spaghetti.
Looking real crusty. It's early. I woke up, so I was like, let me just wash some clothes, because I know the last time I was here, I jetted about it. Oops. So I had some laundry to do. It's 5 o'clock in the morning. Our report time is at 11:20. I haven't even told y'all about the trip because I need to look at it, but I think tonight we go to Savannah, Georgia. So that'll be interesting. And then I need a meal prep, so, and then I want to go back to sleep. I remember, y'all, I told y'all I was craving some spaghetti, so I went to Kroger's last night and bought the stuff to make spaghetti, but by the time I left the grocery store, I ain't had no energy to come and cook, so I just got me some Chick-fil-A last night, but now I'm gonna cook the spaghetti. And I bought, I didn't buy that. I bought me these palmini noodles. They're not that great. I've never tried this brand though. But I'm attempting for real to go back keto, because your girl is big. And I know, I hear y'all, but y'all aren't me, y'all aren't in my body. And then some salads. So let me just spaghetti meatballs, or spaghetti meatballs. Then I bought some ground beef just in case I wanted to mix that in. Also, you know, do some of y'all do that? Actually, like, make the spaghetti with the ground meat and then add meatballs to it? Or do y'all just do spaghetti meatballs? Or do y'all not do meatballs at all? Like, usually I just do spaghetti, ground meat, and then that's my spaghetti. Or noodles, ground beef, that's a spaghetti. But, you know, every now and then, we create something different. So this should be quick and easy to do. And yeah, I should probably go to the gym, but Tired. Okay.
So I just read the back of this to see what palmini noodles are actually really made out of, because I've only ate them and never really known. Palmini. Palmini is a pasta substitute made out of natural plant known as, made out of a natural plant known as heart of palm. When this plant is cut and cooked in the proper way, it resembles, its resemblance to the regular pasta is remarkable. Like I said, if y'all have never tried it, it's kind of like, I don't know, if y'all are one of those texture fruity type people that don't like weird texture type things, this probably isn't for you. But like I said, it gets the job done. I used to eat them all the time back in the day. So gonna cook, watch Queen Sugar. If y'all are Queen Sugar fans, it's back on. So I'm gonna try to get all my TV out the way, so when I get to the hotel later on today, I have quite a bit of real estate work to do. Like a lot, so no distractions later. We'll see. All right, so here are the noodles. Even these look like the texture different from the ones I used to eat, but you have to rinse them off really good because the washing machine started going crazy. Okay, back to the noodles. So yeah, these are the noodles. You have to rinse them off really, really well because whatever they like preserve them in, I guess, is gross. So I'm gonna rinse, put the meatballs in the oven. Got my ragu spaghetti sauce, doing it the lazy way. And then yeah, lunch. So y'all, the elevators at the crash pad are still not working. Last night when I got here, I had to walk up 3 flights of stairs. Okay, see, look, let's see. Yeah, how quickly I forgot. Let me go. Dang it, this is annoying. Elevator's not working. Last night when I got here, I had to walk up 3 flights of stairs with my bags. Mahogany, I just had to move her. I can't get in through here? What in the what? I think the elevator by the front office is supposed to be working. So I just want to move Mahogany, y'all. Sorry, y'all know my brain be everywhere. I just want to move Mahogany. And I was gonna park in the garage, but I don't have a thing to park in the garage, and the garage gate is open, I guess, because the power. I don't really know why it's open, because there's power. I don't know what's going on. I say all of that to say that I'm not walking back downstairs later on today when it's time to go to work with my heavy bags. They can miss me with that. So I'm gonna have to figure out what I'm gonna do. Maybe I'll just drive my car up through the garage when I'm leaving, so I won't be sitting there too long and they won't have time to tow me. But this is still crazy. Like, where is, here's the staircase. Oh, see, look, people have the doors. Oh, wait. Nope, wrong staircase. Okay, let's just keep going to the elevator. And all of this is still because of that crazy winter storm that we had. Where am I? This complex is so massive, y'all. I be getting confused. I need to go here. Found it. Okay, hopefully this elevator up here is working. Then I'm gonna have to walk all the way the other way back around. Just because the doors to the stairs from the outside were closed. Yeesh. Yeesh. Okay. Done everything I need to do. Now I can go lay back down for a couple of minutes, I think. Oh wait, no, I'm here. Oh look, even this door has been propped open. I
have all the doors propped open. They say this elevator is supposed to be working. Yes. All right. That's my workout for the day right there. Made it to the hotel, y'all. I think this is a smoking room. It is strongly smelling. How do I get this one up? I'm struggling. Come on. Okay, but now there we go. All right, got a nice view of the woods, but you can't even open the window. It really smells like smoke in here. And I don't have the time or patience to go downstairs and try to get another room. Oh, this usually I like to sleep on the bed closest to the door. That's just my preference. But that's gonna have to be. Oh yeah, y'all see, we got a double bedroom. Haven't had one of those in a cute little minute. But the bathroom smells like smoke. It's gonna bother me, I know. Let me call them. Or is it? Oh. The phones don't work? The phone don't work? I got work to do, y'all. So I'll just deal with it. See y'all later. All right, couldn't take it. Didn't take that long. And I was already in the room for maybe like a good 30 minutes, but I was just sitting in a chair in the other corner and I hadn't walked into the bathroom and on that, whatever. I didn't smell it because my brain was preoccupied with other thoughts. So now, they've given me a different room. And the crazy thing, I already took my clothes off, like, semi-unpacked my bag, unpacked my lunch kit. Man. Anyway, this is the third floor. I'm supposed to be going to the fourth floor. Okay. All right, back in a smoke-free, smelly room. You know, the funny thing is, y'all, for whatever reason, when they assign crew our hotel rooms, we're always like, well, I feel like, Lord, I feel like we're always at the end of the hallway, and the room, the smoky room, wasn't, and I was excited about it. I was like, ooh, yes, I'm really close to the elevator. That gives me like an extra minute in the morning, right? Now, of course, this room, last room at the end of the hall. Last room at the end of the hall, y'all. So, let's wash my face, open the laptop, get to work. I'm supposed to be editing a vlog today. I'm gonna try. Good morning. I got a lot of sleep, but it's just still hard waking up this early. Right now it's 5:40 Eastern time, which means it's 4:40 Central time. I live off of Central time, but at least I took my little butt to bed last night and I wasn't playing. So, time to shower, get dressed. I really want to make some tea. Ouch, but I think I forgot my stevia. Or maybe it's in my other bag. But my flying partner, the guy I'm flying with, he's on keto too, so maybe he has some. Or maybe it's just the hotel may have some. Who knows? But I just woke up thinking about tea this morning. So good morning. I hope y'all are having a blessed. Well, whatever. Good morning, y'all. Have a blessed day. Hey y'all, we're in flight. This flight is like 2 hours and 43 minutes. Who knew it was gonna be that long? But I'm updating my cabin crew planner to make sure that I'm
50 minutes of sit time, and then we go Dallas to Destin, Walton Beach, Florida. And then that's it for the day. So yeah, this should be pretty smooth. It's a nice quiet flight. I always love that. All right, y'all, we've made it back to Dallas Fort Worth. We have about a 50-ish minute sit or so. Me and my flying partner are both doing keto, so we're like, we could eat, or we're not gonna eat, because there's not really anything here that's super keto friendly. So we're just kind of stretching our legs. Brittany!
How are you?
I'm good.
Are you
videoing?
Is it for your YouTube channel?
Yeah. Yeah, so I don't know if I've told y'all in the vlog or not, but our real crew room had water pipes burst from Snowvid the other day. And now this is our little makeshift crew room, I guess. Look, they got little cots for us to sleep on. There's one over there. Oh, there's like five of them in here.
This is good.
All right. Oh, lunchtime with the guys. On the water.
You can't really see it, but it's like you'll see like a little white puff of smoke coming out.
So, mahi and shrimp. This is not etouffee. This is yellow rice.
Good morning, y'all. Good morning. Good morning. Today is Friday, day 3 of our 4-day trip. Today's a long day, too. We got 4 legs, and I really shouldn't be up this early. I woke up at like 5. I've been up watching YouTube, editing this vlog for y'all. Hopefully I can get it up by tonight. I'm sorry, y'all. Just, I don't be having the time, and I be needing to sleep. So the vlogs will go up when they can go up, but I haven't stopped vlogging. I know some of y'all asked me that, and I'm like, I still vlog, just I haven't edited. Anyways, I haven't been that great of a vlogger, though, this 4-day because I have been kind of vlogging on Instagram. I hadn't really been doing a lot of flight attendant content on my Instagram page. One, because I took a break from Instagram for a while, and then I'm revamping my page. But I decided to kind of vlog this trip on my Instagram stories. So it's kind of hard to vlog and Instagram all at the same time. So with that being said, if you don't follow me on Instagram, go over to AlexiaNikole.Realtor, and you'll still see flight attendant content over there as well. Yeah, and I'm also thinking that I might want to throw the cabin crew planner on sale. I should have probably did this last week or whatever, but furlough flight attendants come back in March. And March starts on Monday, I think, or Sunday, or whenever. March is around the corner. So just a little celebration for them, although I feel like they're going to get refurloughed. I don't really know. I haven't been keeping up so much with the whole furlough situation. But I'm going to throw the cabin crew planner on sale. By the time y'all see this, the sale will probably be over. But I'm sorry. Anyways, I'm just going to lay here for... my alarm won't be going off until... Well, I don't have to get out of the bed until 7 because our van time is at 8. So, it's been a really good trip so far, y'all. I like my crew. We went out... Y'all saw, we went out to eat yesterday. And they're a fun bunch of guys. My flying partner, his name is Jordan. He's been flying since he's 18. I think he's like 31 now or something. He's fun, definitely fun. My captain and first officer, they're fun. They're comical. Like, you call the flight desk. What? You call the flight deck and they answer. They're like, it's Papa John's. You know, like, they're just easygoing guys, and I like it. So, but I think we lose our first officer today. He's done with the trip. He was just doing, I guess, the first two and a half days or something. I don't really know what he said the other day, but I think he leaves us today and then we get a different first officer. I know I've mentioned this before, but this is one of the good things that I like about regionals is that the pilots are younger, you know, because pilots have to go through regionals before they can get to mainline. I guess it's just, you know, the way that their progression works. So I'm the oldest person on the trip, believe it or not. Me and my captain are like a few months apart in age. We're both 88 babies. I'm June, and I think he said he's September. And then the other two were born in the 90s. So, but not everybody's always young. I mean, there's some older pilots and flight attendants here as well. But most of the time you get a nice young crew, and that kind of spruces things up a bit. But yeah, I don't even think I told y'all about the flight. I know I didn't. I didn't even talk to y'all really. Our flight yesterday here, just something about the water in Florida. Like, anytime you get on a plane that's going to Florida, those people are, they like to drink, and we're still not serving anything basically in the main cabin. Everything is on request. I mean, we do have water and soda and juice back there, but there's no beer, no liquor, no wine in the main cabin. But we do have it up front in first class, and I'm working first class this trip. And yeah, they literally drank all the vodka minis. So I was like, oh, okay, y'all is drinking. Had a few people kind of, you know, wanting to complain about the whole mask situation. And before we took off, there was a guy sitting in the back of the aircraft, like second to last row or something. And when me and Jordan were doing our cross checks, he told me, he was like, hey, I've had to ask this guy, you know, multiple times to keep his mask on. And he's trying to hold his cup in his hand to say that he's like drinking. Because our announcement says, you know, if you're drinking or eating, you may briefly lift and lower your mask to eat and drink, right? So this guy was trying to keep his mask off the whole time and literally hold his cup right here. So Jordan was like, I've asked him, and he just keeps like holding the cup right there. So I asked him, and I was like, sir, I need you to put your mask on. And he's like, but I'm drinking. I said, you're not drinking at the moment. Your mask has to be on. He just goes, it needs to be on the whole time. So the lengthy announcement that I just made, because we have to read these announcements verbatim, or we should read them verbatim, and I tried to, and I did that time because it was Florida. And I was like, based on the announcement I just read, yes, sir, you can briefly lift or lower your mask. I said, there's plenty of people with cups, but that doesn't allow them to just keep their mask on. I said, when you need to take a sip, you remove your mask, and when you're done with your sip, you put it back on. And so he was like, really? And I was like, yes. And based on the announcement that I just made, if you cannot comply, you can face criminal or civil penalties. And he just looked at me. And I said, look, we're just trying to have a good flight. We're just trying to get there. I said, nobody wants to deal with these situations, but it is what it is. And he put that mask right back on. So Jordan was like, thank you. And I mean, not that he's a pushover or nothing, but you know, sometimes after you just tell people something so many times, you're just exhausted with it. It's just like, goodness. But then I guess there was another guy. Another guy. And he didn't even tell me about this, and I didn't notice. But when we were getting off, when we were deplaning, he told me that he was going to write this guy up, because every time he told him to put his mask on, he would like lift it up, and then as soon as he would walk away, he would take it back off. And so I guess Jordan told him, he was like, sir, I can't tell you again. I can't give you any more chances. I'm just going to have to, do a report. And he goes, fine, do a report. I don't care. Like, what? These people, like, and the flight was only an hour and 18 minutes. Like, our first flight yesterday was almost 3 hours. So I can understand if, you know, you have a little bit more pushback on the mask for 3 hours. But those people were wonderful. From Savannah to Dallas, not an issue. These Florida folks. Anyways, I'm done venting for the morning. Let me finish editing and stretching clearly. See y'all when it's done.
Made it to the airport, y'all. But we have a bit of a delay. Low ceilings, it's foggy outside. So we'll see when we can take off. And of course, the guys are talking about maybe we can misconnect. And I'm like, no. We're not gonna misconnect because today we literally have like an hour sick in between our flights. Four leg day today. I think I told y'all that. So regardless of, I mean, unless we leave like 2 hours late or something. But I doubt that happens because the fog is lifting now. So let's go. Let's go. You know, the whole time we've been in Florida, I just thought we were still on East Coast time and we weren't. It's Central time in Destin. Did you know that, Jordan? I had no idea. I had no idea that one state could have multiple time zones. That's horrible. I need to go back to, what, elementary school when we learned geography? Goodness gracious. We've made it to somebody's airport and we're hungry. So we came to the only place that has food. There's an alarm going off in the airport, y'all. I don't know why it won't stop beeping, but I'm gonna get something that's not super healthy or, you know, belly fat friendly, but I'm gonna eat it. And I need y'all to mind y'all business. Y'all, we've made it. Three legs down, one to go. But unfortunately, what's the unfortunate part? Both things. We have an hour 13 minute sit and I really just wanted to just turn and burn. And we have to make our way to the new terminal. And we parked it. And I'm tired. But good news, I had a closing today while I was in the air. Mentor mommy Andrea went and stood in for me, so that was very sweet of her. If y'all want more details on that, you gotta watch my real estate vlogs. We're here with no van, stranded in Springfield, Bourne, Missouri. Stranded. Our ride never showed up, so we gotta get a taxi. You know, back in my heyday, I used to be so impatient waiting on the hotel van, but it's really not that bad here at this company. Like, and probably it's because we got all these little small regional airports. So we usually don't have to wait that long. So I was just chilling, relaxing, like nothing. Cap's like, let's go get a taxi. And I'm completely fine with that. Oh, it's a little nipply out here, child. Okay, hold on, let me walk a little faster. All right, y'all, so you know, today was day four, one leg and done day, right? Not. So they assigned me three more legs for today. Augusta term, and then I was gonna have an overnight, or I have still currently right now, overnight somewhere. I don't remember, but Cincinnati. But I wouldn't get there till like 10 o'clock tonight. That's gonna give me like a 13 hour day. But regardless, my flight departure time is at 12:25. And right now it's 12:23. We landed at like 11:45, made it to the gate about 11:50. Doors didn't really open till 11:57. Had to deplane, people were taking their sweet time. Called crew scheduling for a lunch break at 12:15, when the boarding doors should be closing. So I was like, and she's like, okay, we'll send a pre-board. And I'm like, okay, but sis, I'm gonna eat my meal. So we'll see. They did the same to my flying partner, but they had just given him a term. He called, his flight was the same thing, but they reassigned him to a later flight. So I'm secretly hoping and wishing they reassign me to a different flight also. Maybe just one leg in the overnight, because three more legs today, it's a long day, especially since we had a long day yesterday too. But I'm gonna eat my food because I'm gonna need my energy. So I'll keep y'all updated on how the rest of this goes. Y'all see that? Flight closed. Here, let me point it out to y'all. This right here. I got here, they were done boarding pretty much, but it was still open and he was literally on the phone with crew scheduling, the gentleman that was working the gate. And he was like, oh, she just walked up. They were like, okay, well, let us call you right back. But the pre-boarder is already on board. They're like, okay, we'll just let the pre-boarder work it. I mean, so let me call them and see what they have for me now, because I'm sure it's still something.
I'm in my car, so y'all know what that means. I'm going home. Crew scheduling. Some of those people, really and truly, really, like, I really, really feel like they have a God complex and feel like they can just do whatever. But I'll deal with that later. Not in, whatever. Whatever. We're gonna go, not home, but to the crash pad. I'm still good for 2 more days. When I called them, they didn't want to give me anything else. So, okay. Whatever. Whatever. I hope y'all enjoyed that 4-day trip. It was a really, really a good trip. I had a good crew, pilots included. Jordan was fun to work with. He came from Mainline United. He was there for like 8 years, some time ago. And we just had a really good vibe. It's nice to work with people that have the same mindset as you when it comes to doing the job and, you know, all that good stuff. So anyways, thank y'all for watching. As always, love y'all. Until next time, make sure you subscribe, like, and share. Bye. Oh my gosh, y'all, just watching that back or really editing it, like, it just took me back to that moment. That vlog was shot when in like February, the end of February. That was one of the last vlog, not one of, that was the last flight attendant vlog that I ever recorded. So let's you get comfortable, y'all. I got my blanket pulled out because it's chilly in Houston, Texas. Y'all know that's where I live. And it's like 50-something degrees outside. That's chilly to me. I got my tea. Nope. And we're going to talk. So, what happened with that trip? And honestly, y'all, I am the type of person when not so positive things happen or negative things happen, I don't like to ponder on them. I don't even like to keep them in my brain. I push them so far back and move forward that it's just like, I might not remember every single detail of what happened, but I'm gonna try to recall. So on that trip, it was the 4 day or something was going on. I think I was trying to take a meal break. They had called and they had changed up my flight or added on a flight. They did some foolishness that crew scheduling was always doing, right? That put me in a predicament where I did not have time to sufficiently eat. So I called them from my meal break, told them where I was. You know, I was communicating like I was supposed to. All kind of things. You know, I don't know. I think they had tagged that trip onto me like right when we landed, but the plane, the departure time was supposed to be in like 20 minutes from me landing, which was insane, but I needed to eat and just like all of that. So I asked them to send a pre-boarder, right? That's what you do. You say, hey, I need to take my meal break. When you call to take a meal break, they don't question it. They just have to kind of say yes. There was no exact time in our manual that said how long our meal break. There wasn't like you get 15, 30 minutes. The wording just always said like reasonable, a reasonable amount of time. So my reasonable amount of time was where I got off was the gate that I was at. I went and got food close to there. I sat down and ate my food, and then I was gonna make my way to the gate that was way, ways away. So when I called, you know, I told them, hey, I'm over here. I need to get my meal break. It's gonna take me this long. blah, 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 blah. Because, you know, and, you know, I feel like a lot of people always kind of went back and forth, like when you would kind of discuss meal break with different crew. You know, some people believe that you should just get your food and head to the aircraft and then eat on the airplane when you can. I wasn't of that belief, and I never have been, especially if it's like an official meal break, you know? My belief of a meal break is get your food, sit down, eat, enjoy your meal. Have a mental break along with your meal break from the hecticness of just being a crew member and flying and COVID and just all of that. So I enjoyed my meal. Yes, I did. So I called crew scheduling. I'm like, hey, you know, they called me. They were like, how far away are you from the gate? I'm like, you know, I'm walking there. It's going to take me about 10 minutes to get to that gate. Couldn't get there no faster than that. 10 solid minutes, and that's me pumping my watch, asking me if I'm working out, trying to get to the gate, right? So get to the gate. The gate agent is actually at that moment on the phone with her people, you know, trying to figure out what's going on. And I said, hey, I'm here. I'm working the flight. They said, oh, okay. There is a pre-boarder on. And I said, okay, are they going to, you know, they were getting ready to close the flight. And I said, and she was like, well, hold on. Let me see what they want me to do. And so I said, okay, you know, that's fine. You know, pre-boarders are there to pre-board the plane. And as long as I'm there before the doors are closed, we should be good. Doors weren't closed yet. So she calls the people back. She calls operations back. They say, okay, just let the pre-boarder go. Or she called crew scheduling. I don't know who she called. It was either operations or crew scheduling. And they said, okay, just let the pre-boarder go. And I said, okay. So when she told me that, you know, that has nothing to do with me and her. You know, we're just following whoever is directing, right? So then I take it upon myself to call crew scheduling. I said, okay, well, I'm still available. I'm here. They're wanting the pre-boarder to work this flight. I'm available. What do you need me to do? What do you want me to work? You know, whatever, you know, what? And they said, oh, well, we don't have anything for you. So, you know, you'll be released for the day. And I was like, okay, cool. Go in to check my schedule. And it had me as, go in to check my schedule and they marked me as a missed assignment. And I was like, now, wait a minute. You know, I call them back because a missed assignment is like, you know, points. And it's just, it's a no-no, right? It's a no-no. I didn't miss my assignment. I was here at this gate before the door closed. So why do I have a missed assignment? They were like, well, we were waiting on you for this long and this long and this long. And I'm like, well, check the phone. Well, you know, go back and play the phone calls. You know, this is why these lines are recorded. There's no reason for me to have a missed assignment when I told you I took a meal break. It wasn't even 30 minutes, y'all. Like, I constantly kept y'all updated as to what was going on. Every time y'all called, I answered. And y'all was calling. I couldn't even enjoy my food. You called when I got in line. You called when I was paying. You called when I sat down to eat. You called while I was eating. You called while I'm walking there. Like, and I told, the crazy thing is, I know this story kind of sounds, it's not all over the place. It is what it is. When the first crew scheduler I talked to and I said, hey, I need a meal break. And I said, and honestly, it's unrealistic for me to get to this gate, even if I didn't take a meal break in time to start boarding. You know, it just wasn't enough time. I said, can you assign me a different trip? That's exactly what I asked for. It's not that I'm trying to get out of working. I need you to give me a different assignment and have somebody else go work this, because this is what you have people sitting airport standby for and whatever else. So they chose not to do that. They still wanted me to work this flight for whatever reasons, reasons that may have made sense to them, but did not make sense to me, because on the back end of this later on, I found out the person that I had worked the previous flight with, they did the same to him and they had reassigned him a trip that was a little later because it was the same circumstances. So, you know, like situations like that, it's like, well, if you could do that for this person, why couldn't you do that for me? And now why do I have a missed assignment? So that's why that trip ended the way it did, right? So got that missed assignment. I went ahead and, with the union, you know, we were able to fight things like that and provide this, and this, and this. So that happened. Long story short, right? I end up getting that missed assignment removed because, you know, I gave them all my screenshots of the schedule, you know, the time the plane landed, when they added it to me, the phone calls, all of that to show that, you know, I was in reasonable time of my meal break and I showed up at the gate before the doors ever closed, so I shouldn't have had a missed assignment. So it ticked me off. The whole situation it ticked me off. So then the reason why I actually stopped vlogging, right? And like I said before, I don't like to remember just conversations that don't sit right with me. But oh, it's coming back to me now. Okay, so management calls, they say, hey, we need you to come into the office this day, blah, blah, blah. They don't tell you why, they don't tell you anything, right? But I already knew, like, if you're calling me like that without giving me, like, any heads up of what's going on, it's not good. And one, I had already experienced this at a previous airline that was near and dear to my heart. So I was already up on game. Like, I already knew how these airlines get down, right? So called union, wanted to have union representation with me while I was there, and which was a good thing. So I get in there and, you know, they said, hey, we've received a complaint about you in regards to a YouTube channel. And I'm like, okay, here we go. And when they first called, I knew that it had to do something with this YouTube channel, because there would be no other reason for me to be getting called in to management to discuss anything, because I never did nothing wrong. Like, I did my job all the time. Even with this missed assignment situation that had happened, I think it was literally like the week prior, you know, I was still right in what I did. You know, that's why my missed assignment was removed. So I was like, okay, you know, what is it now? Because I've had, either with, I was working for Envoy Air, now that I no longer work for them, I can say the airline name, y'all already knew. Anyways, Envoy Air is a regional airline owned by American Airlines, wholly owned regional airline, right? Okay. So they say, is this YouTube channel named Alexia Nicole your YouTube channel? And I said, yes, it is. They said, okay, so you do post these videos. I said, yes, I do. So, you know, they brought the complaint to my attention, and complainers, all of y'all, if y'all are watching, just stop. Like, stop. Stop complaining on all these flight attendant YouTubers or anybody that is YouTubing some sort of their job and reporting it to their companies, because y'all are miserable. Like, miserable. I mean, I've received multiple complaints at times, like, over the span of me flying and vlogging, I had received multiple complaints, people complaining about my YouTube channel, y'all, about vlogging, you know, just the stupidest complaints you could ever hear. So this one was, I wasn't wearing my mask on the plane, which this one took me out. I said, what? Like, I had to laugh, because I was like, now, I know I'm masked up when I'm on the plane. Once, I know that I wear my mask on the plane. And once I touch down on airport property, you know, once I get out of my vehicle, my mask is on. You know, maybe for me walking to the car, to the elevators, I might be in the process of me putting my mask on, but I'm still outside. But once I actually get inside those airport doors, my mask is on, especially in front of customers. So, you know, there's two people, there's manager there and then somebody there from HR, and then I had my union rep with me. And I'm just like, I said, honestly, I don't know what you're referring to. You know, you're gonna have to show me where this complaint is coming from. So they showed me, and it was literally me on the plane in between flights. So everybody had already boarded. It's just me on the aircraft and maybe even the pilots up in the flight deck or whatever. But I had my mask down, you know, like, and I was probably talking to y'all, telling y'all what was going on with the day. But there was nobody on the aircraft, nor was I out in the terminal. I was in the plane, minding my business. Nothing out there, right? So that was the complaint. And I explained to him, I said, it's exactly what you see. You can see in the video, there's nobody on the plane. But this person who complained felt like I could be coughing and spreading my germs all over the seat, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, which is a stretch. You know, it was just a stretch. So, but because of that complaint, that led my airline to now going through and watching more of my videos to find any other thing that I did that could be wrong, you know, or outside of our social media guidelines and all of that stuff. So they brought up a few other things, me showing the inside of my hotel room. So not even like when I was with JetBlue, I had got a complaint about me showing, looking through the window and showing the surroundings of the hotel, and somebody saying, no, I'm sure this is a crew member, somebody that reported and said, anybody can know that hotel and know, you know, what's outside and what the views look like. And now people are going to know, you know, where we stay as crew. And then, you know, that's against our privacy and da, da, da. So I had that complaint. So I stopped showing the outside of hotels at that point in time, right? Now this complaint, now they're saying, I'm in the room. I don't have on my uniform. You know, there's nothing that actually says Hilton or Hyatt or whatever we're staying at. It's just me talking to y'all in a hotel room. But I can't show that either because certain hotels have beds that all look the same or wall colors that are the same, or there's just distinctive things. Even a pen all the way over there can tell somebody, you know, where we're staying. And I was just like, okay, you know, like if we want to consider that valid, then fine. Like, ooh, child. If we want to consider that as a valid reason, then okay. You know, and I wasn't being argumentative. I was just like taking it in, you know, taking in every little thing that they could nitpick about the videos. You know, they even mentioned, you know, at the end, you know, like, I don't do it all the time, but at the end of my videos, you know, I have my end screen that has like all my contact information. Watch this next video, my Instagram, my real estate email, blah, blah, blah. And they were like, well, you know, are you using these videos to promote your real estate and blah, 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 because at the end you have this and da, da, da. You know, flying is supposed to be your first priority. And if you have a second job, you're supposed to let us know and blah, blah. And I, you know, just like, let me tell y'all something. I enjoyed flying so much. And I never really flew, especially after JetBlue. I never really flew for the money at Envoy because we ain't make no money, okay? No coins. So I was doing it solely just for the enjoyment of flying and being able to interact with customers and of course your benefits. But once that man tapped on my second job, which real estate is my primary career, you know, that rubbed me wrong. And I was like, what you saying? You know, like I can't sell real estate because there's plenty of flight attendants and other people out here that have second careers and blah. And he was like, well, no, I'm not saying that, you know, but you're supposed to, you know, let us know and blah, blah, which was a stretch as well, because after he stepped out, this is the HR guy, I asked management and union and I said, is this really a thing? And they were like, you know, not really, like unless it was like another job directly, you know, correlating with aviation or something, then yes. But just even the thought of it irked my entire soul. So long story short, because they decided, because of all of this and all this evidence that they found of me breaking social media policies, and I feel like it was other things that they kind of brought up. I don't know what I did with that paper. It's probably shredded and in the trash a long time ago. They wrote me up, y'all. They wrote me up, and they wrote me up to, they skipped warnings and step ones and step two, and they basically, I'm giving y'all all the tea because it is what it is. They basically said, you know, either you take all these videos down, you stop flying, or we have to let you go. That was it, right? And I was just like, okay, wow. Like, it's like, and honestly, y'all, I sat there, I thought about it, because I was just like, this, I never really loved that airline as much as I love JetBlue. Just the environment overall. You know, there was nothing wrong with any person in particular. The crews were fine. They were fun. But it just was not the same experience that I had prior. And I was just trying to make it work. You know, just trying to make it work. But a lot of the times, it was just an inconvenience, honestly. So when they said that at that point, I was just like, okay. You know, let me just pull back from vlogging. Let me just stop. Let me keep my job, you know, whatever. So I had already made that decision, but they had gave me this thing and they said, okay, well, you know, this is what it's going to be. Either you're going to do all of this, take all of this down. And then I'm still on like now a probationary period of 2 years. 2 years of where I couldn't have any complaints, any anything, right? I mean, attendance was separate from this, but just behavioral stuff, like for 2 years I had to be excellent, which I had no problem being excellent because I was already excellent. But you just never know. You never know when you will run into a passenger that just don't like you, that wants to complain, that wants to whatever. And these airlines are always going to take the side of these passengers. So that's what happened with that, right? So I said, all right, I signed that little thing. I'm going to be good for 2 years. I'm going to take these vlogs down. I'm going to stop vlogging. So that's when I stopped vlogging. And y'all were all like, why have you stopped vlogging? And I really couldn't discuss it. Like I could not discuss it. They made me say I will not discuss what is going on. So that, like, didn't even want me to tell my crash pad mates or anybody else, you know, like it was all of that. So it just really put me in a headspace of like, after that I was like, well, this really isn't enjoyable anymore, because like, one, I'm fighting to find enjoyment in just working for this company. Vlogging was really the only thing that still kept me happy about flying at the time, because I loved sharing these experiences with y'all. Like, I did it for y'all, not even so much for me. I mean, what do I really get out of it? Not much. So I did it for y'all because you all liked it. You know, I was open. I shared a lot. I gave all the tea. And that's probably what people was complaining on me for, because I was giving too much tea like I'm giving right now. But hey, it is what it is, right? So fast forward to July of this year. Today is November 5th, right? So oh yeah, so real estate has been extremely great for me this year. No complaints, right? And just with the way that aviation ramped back up, and I didn't have the flexibility in my schedule anymore to be able to drop days, hold a line, like I was back on hard reserve. It was no longer feasible for me, right? You know, like a lot of flight attendants will go and like, you know, apply for FMLA and qualify for it somehow and be able to call out certain days. You know, like this is stuff that y'all ain't gonna hear about from a current flight attendant. But this is what they do. You know, they go to the doctor, they say, oh, I get migraines, you know, I need this, I need FMLA. I can't remember what it's called. But oh, I need FMLA so I can be able to call out, you know, here and there when I'm having a really bad migraine, and you know, then it's covered and you're paid or whatever. I tried to go through that process, right? And actually, and I ended up getting it, but well, I ended up not being able to actually qualify for FMLA because the previous year I didn't fly enough hours. You have to have a certain amount of hours that you've flown the year before to qualify for FMLA. But because I was on leave, what, like 5 months out of the year of 2020, I just didn't have enough hours. So they granted me something else that's similar to FMLA, but it wouldn't allow me to call out and drop days the way that I would have needed. So it all just boiled down to, honestly, why I decided to hang up my wings in July. It's been that long since I stopped flying, y'all. It just came down to what was more important to me. And my real estate career is just more important to me. And maybe if I would have loved Envoy more, or if I just felt like I really benefited from being there, with everything that had taken place from February to that MA to the YouTube complaints to all of that, it was just stacking up and up with just negative experiences. So I turned it in 2 weeks notice one day. I said, I got things to do. I got closings happening. I have clients that I needed to be here in Houston for. And the beauty of me mixing those two careers was because I had all the flexibility in being a flight attendant. When that was taken away and then I had all these negative experiences, it just equated to me no longer wanting to do it. And at that time, I was just like, I just don't want to work for this company. Whatever I do, however I move forward, y'all know, if you've been watching long enough, Southwest was always my dream airline. You know, I want to get to Southwest. I want to be based in Houston. Hopefully it will be able to give me that balance and that flexibility back. But as the time got closer to Southwest then opening their application, I think in these few months, I have just gotten so comfortable being at home, not being on the go all the time, just not living that lifestyle of a flight attendant. And it's great, y'all, but you have to be in the headspace, and you just have to want to be that, you know, you just have to want to do it. And I have just gotten to where I no longer wanted to do it for anybody. No airline, like nothing. But that doesn't mean that I did not apply to Southwest. I talked to the good Lord. Y'all know I believe in Jesus. I believe in, you know, all of that. I believe in God. So I talked to him and I said, you know what? At first, when they first opened their application, or I heard about Southwest opening their application, of course I have my Southwest friends that just really kept me in the loop and they really wanted me there. And as soon as the application opened, I had so many people from Southwest reach out to me and say, Alexia, you'll be great. We want you over here, you know, blah, 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 blah. And of course, these are just not just flight attendants, but they're flight attendants, you know, no, like it wasn't like no higher ups or anything crazy like that. And so I was just like, okay, let me consider, because this is what I've been waiting for so long. This is why I was trying to stick it through with Envoy and then, you know, get this opportunity and then just hopefully have a smoother transition. And that was the goal. That was what I was really holding out for. But I ended up quitting Envoy in July when Southwest opened their application just, what, a month ago? Maybe not. I don't even think it's been a full month. Whatever. Yeah, maybe. I don't know. Whenever Southwest opened their application, I did apply. But at that time, I was feeling 50-50 on if I even wanted to go back, right? I was just like, do I want to really go fly again? And I mean, I thought about it long and hard. And the harder that I thought about it, and the more that I just enjoy my life, and you know, my real estate business is growing, my personal life is doing personal things, you know, just all of that, I was just like, I feel like uprooting what I have now, going back into this career that I know is now going to make me not have the stability that I currently have. And I'm enjoying the stability. I mean, 4 years of being, I guess, quote unquote, unstable, or just being up and down and commuting and all of that, it's tiring, you know? And I mean, you love it, but it's also tiring. Went through the application process with Southwest, all of that, and maybe like a week before my face-to-face was scheduled, I already knew in the back of my mind that I didn't want the job. You know, I was just doing it kind of so to, one, just to make sure that I wasn't allowing an opportunity to pass me by, because, you know, this is something that I've wanted for so long, and it's like, okay, if God blesses me with it, then maybe I should do it. You know, that was my mindset, and I was like, well, and then if I don't get it, I just don't get it, and I won't be mad. Like, I won't even be sad, because I really don't want to, you know, which sounds so unfair to all these other, you know, how many ever 20,000 plus candidates that they receive, like they always do. You don't even want the job and you're gonna take it. But for me, that is what I needed to validate whatever decisions I was making in my life. I am the type of person where I have to move forward through processes and just see where God leads me, without just like cutting things short before I really know what it could have been. So long story short, I didn't end up getting offered the position with Southwest. Did my face-to-face. And just like in 2019, I felt like I killed it. I studied for it. I did what I needed to do. But I wasn't offered the job. And this time, y'all, I smiled. That sounds so bad. But I read that TBNT email, thanks but no thanks. And like a relief just lifted off of me. Literally, y'all. Literally, a relief just lifted off of me, because I was dreading getting the CJO and then having to go forward and make more decisions of, do I still really want to do this? So, yeah. So my flight attendant career is officially done. It was a great 4.5 years, just a solid 4 years, because I started flying in July and I quit in July. So a solid 4 years of great times, great memories, great people that I'm always going to hold near and dear to my heart. The growth of a beautiful YouTube channel, having all of you all just support me throughout whatever I've been going through the last 4 years. So that is a long way to say, no, I am no longer flying. I am no longer a flight attendant, and I no longer desire to be one, which I know might sound sad to some of y'all, but I find it to be beautiful. I think people are supposed to just continue to grow, and, you know, nothing is wrong, baby. At one point in time, I thought I would have been one of those flight attendants that was flying for a lifetime and was going to retire. And 25 years later, I would still be in the sky and all of that. But that clearly, that's just not the path that the Lord has for me. And I am okay with it. Trust and believe me when I say I am okay with not flying and not being in the air. I'm not going to say never again, because never is a strong word. Who knows what may happen later on down the line, but right now, my sole focus is just being an entrepreneur, you know, starting new businesses, living my best life, finding a husband finding me, you know, some kids or whatever, and just feeling settled and happy and not always on the go. Travels will still happen. I will still take y'all on those. So that trip that I just went to, when I went to Jamaica, oh, I didn't take off to Jamaica, but when I went to Jamaica, when I went to Santorini, like that was all no flight attendantness. I was done being a flight attendant then, but I'm still able to travel because I've been doing great in my career and my funds are good, and I can buy plane tickets. So yeah, y'all, that's that. But with that being said, before I forget, So speaking of entrepreneur and businesses and stuff, I still have a handful of cabin crew planners, y'all. I'm not going to be making a second edition, but it's still a great planner. It is undated, and if y'all remember, it has the month, the monthly overview, monthly budget, income tracker, expense tracker, bill organizer, shopping list, weekly planner, and then it goes into your day-to-day. And then it has note pages as well. So, cabin crew planner, I am discounting this baby. This is a 6-month planner. I am discounting this to $10. $10. So, for you, all you wonderful brand new flight attendants that are getting into this career, I'm telling you, this planner is what you need, just especially that first 6 months, just to be able to organize your new lifestyle, because it's going to do a doozy on you, right? It's going to do a doozy. So go ahead, go to cabincrewplanners.com. Pick you up two of these. They're going to be $10. So spend you a quick little $20, have you a year worth of cabin crew planner. Tell your friends about them. Help me get rid of these things. It's really just maybe like 20 of them left, honestly. So I don't have to throw them away because they taking up space. All right, y'all. Thank you so much. Let me get closer. Thank you so much for the support in my flight attendant journey. Any journey that I've taken you all, thank you for watching. Thank you for subscribing. If you choose to unsubscribe because I no longer have content that suits your needs, I totally get it. But thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. I'm not leaving YouTube. I'm just leaving this flight attendant stuff behind, okay? So I will no longer discuss anything flight attendant related. I'm not going to answer no DMs. I ain't answering no emails. I'm not doing any of that, y'all, because I am just on to newer and different things for my life. All right, y'all. Thanks for watching. Make sure you subscribe, like, and share. Until next time. Bye.